growing stronger together. How many of y'all are starting to believe that? We're growing stronger together. Return is stronger together. We're better together. Growing stronger together. So we've been going over the six purposes of the church at Return Church. And today's part four and part six. So I'm tag teaming two together. Our statement of purpose, it's on our webpage. We talk about it all the time. You probably have it memorized. If you don't, that'd be a wonderful thing to memorize. But you see, there's six things, the way we give Jesus glory and honor here at Return. And that's through our worship, through evangelism, through discipleship. And today we're going to talk about ministry. The fifth one's fellowship, and the sixth one's helping the vulnerable. So I'm going to talk a little bit about helping the vulnerable, because it's kind of a tag along to ministry. It's one of the ministries that we do. It's not the only ministry by any means, but it's something that we do at Return. So I'm going to talk to you about ministry and helping the vulnerable. And don't shut down on me, because you might be thinking, well, I'm not a minister. I'm hoping to redefine the term ministry to you today, so you will understand that you are called to be a minister. The preacher at the church is not the only minister in the house. All believers are supposed to grow in God to the point where they become ministers and help serve the others. See, Jesus, you know, we talked last week about the Great Commission, and this is the Great Commandment. That's what it's mostly noted as by most Bible scholars, the Great Commandment. Jesus said these words, "And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength." That means your entire being, give yourself to Him. The second is this, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." There's no other commandment greater than these. So if you really want to summarize what Christianity is, it's loving God and loving people. Loving God, loving people. There's no room for hate anywhere in this equation. The only thing I'm going to let you hate is the devil, all right? You can hate him if you want to hate him. He's still not going to keep him from coming at you. He's just going to come at you more, but you can hate him if you want to hate him. But, beloved, we are to love all of mankind. The Good Samaritan teaches us who our neighbor is. Your neighbor is not just the person you live next door to. You may call, well, that's my neighbor. Well, that is a neighbor, but it's also the person you're seated next to in church, and it's the person you work around. It's the person you shop around. It's the people that you interact with through your daily lives. Those are your neighbors. They may be a Muslim or a Buddhist or a Jehovah's Witness or a Mormon or an atheist or an agnostic. It doesn't matter. They may be rich or poor. They're your neighbors. God doesn't let you single out any group of people and say it's all right to hate these people. Now, the great commandment is that all believers learn to love God with everything they've got and in love all of mankind. Now, what does that look like? How does that play out in your daily life? And then who is your neighbor? Everybody's your neighbor. How well are we loving? That's the fruit of the Spirit. That's the mark of a true disciple. How well are you loving? Can you love people in church that you disagree with? Can you love people at work that run you crazy? Can you love someone that hates your guts? Can you love your enemies? Bless those that hate you. Can you pray for those that use you? Fourth chair of discipline. This is the theme where we are. First chair is the secret chair. This is for the lost and the outreach. If y'all were here last week, you follow this. I won't spend much time on it. But this is the chair in the church. That's for the lost. There's always a chair in our church for the lost. And all of us should be saying, come and see. Whosoever will, let them come. Come to the house of God. Come, I want you to meet Jesus. I want to introduce you to the Savior of the world. Come and see. So there's a secret chair in our church that we want to keep full. But once they get to Jesus and get connected to Him, be born again, they advance to the believer chair. And in the believer chair, this is where we grow. This is where we build. This is where we mature in God. We're little children in this chair, and we're not to stay little children. We're to grow in God. We're not to continue to drink milk and have someone spoon feed you the rest of your life. You're to learn to grow and get your spiritual molars and teeth so you can eat the meat of God's Word and truly grow and become a minister. and you're a minister or a worker, and that's chair three, and that's where we are today, and here's where God's going to equip you for the ministry, prepare you to go out and help other people. And ultimately, we want to grow to become the disciple. The fourth chair is the disciple chair. Not only a disciple, but a disciple maker that can multiply the nature of Christ wherever they go. So chair three focuses on others. Now, number one, chair seeker. Well, who's the focus? The lost people. They're just as important as you are. That's what we got to learn. There's not one of them out there not important to God. Chair two, the focus is on the believer, and that's where you learn discipleship. That's the component of discipleship, a very purpose of our church. We've got to grow up and become disciples. Chair three, the focus now turns to others. See, when you're sitting in chair two, the focus is all about you. It's an inward thing. You are to look at yourself and examine yourself and learn to grow and be transformed by the renewing of your mind every day. This is a chair of growth, of building. But this focus is on you. There's going to come a day when your focus is going to shift from you to other people. And when you're in the minister chair, you don't nearly spend as much time thinking about you as you do others. You spend your time with the Lord every morning. You eat spiritually on your own every morning. You abide in Christ, and then you can move out and help others from chair three. The focus in chair three is on other people. The culture I was raised in for many years in the religious world, the focus was always on me in chair two. It never shifted from there. But this is where return has got, as we're moving on with God, He's trying to teach us all, it ain't all about you, honey. It's about other people. There's other people out there that God wants you to reach. So ministry, this ministry chair, chair three, is, I could use terms like working, serving, helping, teaching, encouraging, loving. See, we can all love people. You don't have to be a great Bible teacher to love people, to help people, to serve people. See, ministry is totally relational. Now, you remember what I told you about chair one, that it was like totally relational? Remember that relational evangelism? You don't have to have this ability to proclaim the gospel. You can make friends and you build the trust, and you can bring them to someone that knows how to proclaim the gospel if you don't. It's totally relational. This discipleship chair is like totally relational, 100% relational. It's about you building your relationship with Jesus Christ and growing in that. And then chair three is relational because now it's you and Jesus together. You are going to go out into the world and make friends and help people and love people. But it's absolutely 100% relational. Now, some people just don't like people. Now, that's a problem if you're going to try to move into chair three. It is. And some of us, I often tell this story. Many years ago, my boys are like 30, 33 and I don't know, maybe they're 32 and 30. I don't know. But when they were like 8 and 6, I'm in the car with them. We're driving down South Mississippi on the interstate. And my little boy in the front, Cy, says, "Dad, I just love everybody." And I'm driving, and that really blessed me. I said, "Cy, me too. I just love everybody too." A couple minutes go by, no more words, all quiet. My little boy, Levi, in the back seat says, "Dad, all people bother me." And I'm driving, I'm thinking, I said, "Me too, Levi, me too." I said, so I think on one, we had this one side of us that just loves everybody, and the other side, no, don't really want to do that. So, see, the thing is, it's easy to love some people. But some people are hard to love. If they're so wounded inside, it's like, you know, odds are if you saw a dog wounded on the side of the road today and you pulled over to try to reach down to help him, he's going to bite your hand. And so most people have been hurt really bad in life. You reach out, the first hand that reaches out to help them, they're going to bite it. And then you say, "Ooh, I don't like ministry. That part of ministry is no fun." Well, you know, ministry, sometimes you get your hand bit. Sometimes it's dirty. Sometimes it's very unpleasant. Sometimes you just got to work with people where they are. But we're to love everybody, lovely and unlovely. Are y'all following this? And I talked to you last week about the spectrum of spirituality. And the reason I bring this up again is because it's so important to understand there's nobody on this spectrum unimportant to God or less important to God. Some people over on the minus 10 side, you know, they're atheist or in some strange religion, and they're not even thinking about Christ. They've got no desire for Jesus. And those are kind of hard people to communicate. You know, those people are just as important to the Lord as you are. And you need to love these people. And love's the only thing that's going to move them toward the cross. They're not going to get moved any other way. But if someone can come in their life and love them and teach them and help them, maybe they'll just start moving. And maybe they start considering and get to a minus five. These are the people that consider the claims of Christ. All right, I'm thinking about it. I'm going to church. I'm reading things. I'm asking questions now. You know, my heart's being stirred. You got to keep loving these people and keep helping these people and being a friend to these people. Because ultimately, you're going to get to the point that someone's going to have the opportunity to lead them to the Lord, and they're going to get born again and saved. Now they've become a part of the family of God. Now they're in chair two. They're a believer now. And then they start growing in God. And maybe they're a baby Christian for a few years and make a lot of mistakes. And someone's got to be very patient with them because they're really making mistakes all the time. That's okay. They're a baby. A baby's not supposed to be an adult. And that's why you can't be judging people just because they're not walking where you're walking. How do you expect a baby to walk like a 20-year-old? It's not going to happen. You need to be very, very patient with people during these first few years of their born-again experience with Jesus. Can I get an amen on that? That's important. If not, you run them off. They get wounded. You expect more out of them than you should. Just love them where they are. Jesus is what's going to change them. You're not going to change them. He's going to change them. Then they grow and they mature. And now there may be a plus five, and now they're growing in God and ready to get out and start ministering to people in some way. And then they become one day a disciple maker. Now, which one of those people in that spectrum is the most important? There's not one more important than the other or less important than the other. So this means wherever you go in life, you go in Walmart, maybe you got some of these people. Some of these people, some of these, maybe at the workplace, you got everybody in the spectrum. Even you could come in this building right here on a Sunday morning and have everybody on the spectrum right here, different places. And it's our job just to love them all, to love them all. Some people think you got to believe just the way I believe before I'm going to bring you in my circle and really love you. No, remember, you got to make them belong before they believe. Don't make them believe before they belong. It's important to make them all feel welcome and loved before they belong. Danger, danger, warning. Don't leave chair too soon. See, a lot of believers are just puppies in the Lord. They're just babes in the Lord, but they want to go help everybody else. And they'll jump over here before they're ready. You got to become a friend of sinners. If you're going to become a friend of sinners, you need to be a friend of Jesus first. You got to build your relationship with Jesus before you come over here and try to help convert in the world. Because if you're not careful, the world will convert you. You get out there in the world too early, Satan will eat your lunch and all of a sudden swallow you up and you're worse shaped than you were. See, you're a human being, not a human doing. Have you ever said, "Hi, I'm Bill. I'm a human doing." No, I'm a human being. You got to learn to be and grow in Christ before you do for Christ. Be in Christ, grow in Christ before you do for Christ. Are you following that? An immature believer will substitute his relationship with Jesus for ministry because he thinks helping the poor or doing these good deeds, this is what my relationship with Jesus is. No, that's what you do for him. It's over in this chair you develop this intimacy and this love relationship with the Lord himself. And don't mix those two things up. your relationship with Jesus is one thing. Your ministry, that's something totally different. I love this verse in Isaiah 30. In returning and rest, ye shall be saved. In quietness and trust shall be your strength. So in the believer chair, remember that every day. It's all about resting in Him and being quiet and still in Him. Here's a little comparison I did. The difference in being and doing. Being is chair two, the believer. Doing is chair three, the minister. In chair two, it's about intimacy with Jesus. As you advance and grow in God, it becomes about ministry or activity. Chair two is abiding in Christ. Chair three is serving others for Christ. Chair three is interior. That's inside my guts, in my inner belief system. And it's invisible. Chair three is exterior, and it's visible. See, chair two, it's what you're doing when nobody's watching. And if you get that right, then chair three, when everybody's watching what you're doing, it's going to match what you were doing when nobody was watching. You become a big phony and a hypocrite in chair three, and you can put on a show if chair two is not done correctly. Are y'all following that analogy? I'd rather see you quit the ministry, sit down and grow and learn how to abide in Christ and Him and you, and learn who you are in Christ, and then later go out and launch back into the ministry. Chair two is about perspective. Chair three is about practice. Chair two is about rest and growth. Chair three is about work. Chair two is about solitude and being still before God. Chair three is about engagement. Chair two is about prayer and Bible study. And chair three is about moving and working. Can y'all see the difference there? Ministry. Here's the Greek. Let's go to the Greek and find out what this word means. I'm not going to try to pronounce the Greek word. There it is for you. Attendant. A servant. Aid. Official. Service. Especially a Christian teacher. This is coming out of the Strong's Concordant in the Greek lexicon. Ministering, office, relief, service, ministering. Those who execute the commands of others. That means somebody's your boss. You hear that? Those who execute the command of others. The service of those who prepare and present food. Now that comes from the root word. There's your Greek word again. And it means to run errands. An attendant. A waiter at the table or in other menial duties. Especially a Christian teacher, pastor, deacon, minister, servant. Oh, I want to be a minister. What it really means is to wait tables. To be a servant. To let somebody else boss you. In other words, Jesus is the boss. When you go from chair two to three, all of a sudden now you got a boss. And where ministers miss it is they want to be the boss. And America's and materialism, the society we live in, the culture we live in of materialism and greed and covetousness, we've redefined success by money and power and fame. And therefore, we look at these superstar ministers as that's what it's supposed to be. In fact, this same word is used in Europe about politicians, high-ranking officials. They'll call them ministers in many countries. So we now see this word minister as this position of power and control and fame and wealth and success. That's not at all what the word means in your Bible. When God's called us to ministry, He's called us to the low place, not the high place. I didn't get any amens on this. Y'all don't like this. Brother Kenny's here. Brother Kenny's a high-ranking official for the Louisville Metro Police Department. He's held many, many big positions over there. He told me, we went to coffee one day, and he says, Brother Hudson, one day I'm going to retire from the police force, and I'd like to get involved in the ministry. And I said, okay, what does that look like to you? What does that mean? He says, that means hand me a mop and show me where to mop. Show me where the bathroom is so I can clean it. He gets it. See, that's powerful. And it's power. You know, I feel the power of God on me when I just tell you the story there, because ministry is a calling to service. It's a calling to the low place. who will be the greatest? The disciples were arguing among themselves who would be the greatest among them. Now, can you imagine they spent, at this point in the game, probably over 3 years with Jesus, and they're still arguing about who's going to be the big shot, who's going to be the boss. I want to control this. I want to control this. Jesus has to be just like rolling his eyes thinking, when are these guys going to get this? So he said, he told them, in this world, the kings and great men lord it over the people, yet they are called friends of the people. But among you, it will be different. Those who are the greatest among you shall take the lowest rank, and the leader should be like a servant. Who is more important, the one who sits at the table or the one who serves? The one who sits at the table, of course, but not here, for I am among you as the one who serves. Jesus, the Lord of glory, Jesus, he said, forget all this arguing about the high place. It's not going to be that way. You've got to learn how to come down into the low place. If I had a bucket of water right now, if I poured it on the ground, is it going to run up to the high place or the low place? And so love is poured out water. It's poured out. When the love of God gets poured out, it goes to the lowest place. You can't ever feel the love of God as long as you're on your high horse. As long as you're up in your pride, God can't even touch you. You got to humble yourself. Get down in the low place. And that's where the waters flow. So what ministry is not? It's not bossing and controlling other people. It's not about you. It's about Jesus and those he serves. It's not about being a big shot. There are 384,000 churches in America. The poll I read showed the average size to be 67. If you take out the sliver of the mega churches, that's less than probably 0.1%, and you reduce that, then your average size is going to drop below 50. And I can't tell you how many ministers I've met that should shut their church down because they got it in their mind the only way they can serve God is to pastor a church. And some of these people are controlling and dominating and very dictatorial, and they think they're the people are there to serve them, and they squeeze every last drop of energy and money out of their people. And that they're on an ego trip, and I've interacted with them, and I just want to say, shut it down, man. Go get a job. Apply at Ben's Bargain or something. Let's do something different than this. But they've got it in their mind. The only way to serve God is to pass their church, so they just continue this circle of insanity. And now some small churches are mighty blessed by God and anointed by God. And I've been in country churches where the power of God was so strong, you had goosebumps on you from the minute you get there, the minute you leave. And I've also been involved in some of these things where it's almost like little cults, where the preacher is a cult leader, and he totally dominates and controls the people. That is not the way a church should be. That is not the way a minister should be. That is not the way a pastor should act. The pastor's here to serve the people, not the other way around. If y'all ever see me just start bossing y'all and controlling y'all and trying to get something from y'all, run me off immediately. I want nothing. I'm here to serve. I'm here to give. I'm here to help you in your spiritual journey. Are y'all following that? American culture, we talked about that. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap for Return Church in Jesus Christ. See, the American culture of greed, covetousness, materialism has redefined the meaning of success to many pastors. The prosperity gospel is a great deception. Sure, there's some truths in it, but it's all out of balance. It's a bird with one wing, and it's all flying in a circle because there's a balance to everything. And it's made heroes out of these great preachers, and they pay them. One preacher, they just, to lure him, he just took a church of 20,000. They gave him a house worth $1.8 million. And they're advertising that, writing about it. And I'm thinking, you know, I really don't think Jesus would have had $1.8 million house, but maybe he would have. I don't know. I just know that what we're seeing on TV doesn't match my New Testament I'm reading on what this thing's supposed to look like. And I don't want us at Return to fall in that kind of trap where this thing becomes about money and power and that the odor of that is just pride. And we want this to be all about humility and service and love and helping people. Even if this church grows very large one day, we never want to change that culture at Return. We're gonna keep this thing the way it's supposed to be. Ministry is about being served. It's not about being served. It's about serving. I've been around preachers that, man, they had a whole entourage of people just serving them all the time. Just serving them. It's all about them. That stinks in the nostrils of God. Jesus never did it that way. Ministry is totally relational. Now, this is the picture of ministry. If you want to really understand ministry, now, none of us really understand this analogy because we don't come in our robes and our sandals and we didn't walk to church. You may have had some salt or some ice or water on your shoes a little bit, but you just wipe it off at the door. If you had come in your sandals today, it would have been muddy. You would have had mud between your toes. So when they walk in the door, there was a servant there in rich people's homes to wash everybody's feet before they came in for dinner. So Jesus had the Passover meal, and look at this. He said he knew the Father had given him authority over everything. So he knew he was the creator of the world, the boss of the whole world. He could control anything he wanted to. He had all power, all authority. So he had come from God. He's going to return to God. He knew all of that. So what did he do? He took his robe off. He disrobed himself. And he wrapped a towel around his waist. And he poured water into a basin. And he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel he had. And you remember when Peter said, no, you're not going to wash my feet. And he said, if I don't wash your feet, you know, I have no part of you. And then Peter said, wash my head and everything. And what he was trying to say is, I've come to take all the sin off of you. I have to wash your feet. Because that's why the Son of Man came into the world. That's why the Son of God became a Son of Man. Because I'm about to go to the cross and I'm going to remove all the sin from you. And I'm here to wash your feet and wash it off of you. He's trying to say, and the very next thing he tells his disciples, you do the same thing to each other. This is what I want you to do. This is what ministry is. Now this word towel, it's only in the Bible these two times. Only two times this word's in the Bible. It doesn't mean your nice plush towel you bought from Macy's. This was a servant's towel that was used for washing feet. The Bible says a towel which servants put on when to work. This was a servant towel. It was a towel they probably washed it every day because it's something they used a lot. This was a servant's towel. Jesus knew the tool he had in his hand and what it was for. It was to wash the feet. And he then tells them after he's done, I want y'all to do the same thing. He says, after washing the feet, he put on his robe again, sat down and asked, do you understand what I was doing? You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right, because that's what I am. And since I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet. I've given you example to follow. Do as I've done unto you. Now, we don't go to a cross and bleed for people. He's already done that for us. But now that he has done that, and he's risen from the dead, and he ascends at the right hand of the Father, and he sent the Holy Spirit, which fills our being, he's called us to go out into the world and be salt and light, and take a towel with you when you go. And when you come up to someone that has rejection on them, and they've been wounded, learn how to love them and wash that rejection off of their feet. If they're full of anger, love on them. Love. Wash that anger off their feet. What about if they're full of discouragement? Then learn how to get down so low and love people and get the mud between their toes. Clean their feet. Clean the anger, the hurt, the rejection. What if they're an addiction? What if they're in a great addiction? Beloved, I'm a believer that if you love people, if you'll get down on your knees and love people and wash, you can wash that addiction off of their feet. You can, what about the hate? Man, everywhere you go, the world's full of hate. We're disciples and we got a towel of love, and we're going to have to learn to use the towel to wash the hate off of people. Deception. False identity. There's so many things. In the world, everybody's feet's dirty with something. It's our job You don't have to be a great gospel orator. You don't have to be able to have your theology just perfect. They don't need to know that right now anyway. All they know is they're dirty. They're stained with the world. They're hurting. They're full of hate. They're full of rejection. They're full of damage from wounds from the past. And they just need somebody that will come to them and love them and humble themselves. That's what a minister is. Whenever you go out into the world, keep your towel with you. I'm talking figuratively, of course. Please don't bring a towel to Walmart and get out and start trying to clean somebody's feet. In fact, some churches, and I used to belong to a church that did this, we'd have a foot washing ceremony once or twice a year. And there's nothing wrong with that. I'm not downing that. But because we did that, we didn't think we had to do this. That's me, my perspective. In other words, let's have a foot washing ceremony a couple times a year, and I don't have to take my towel out into the world and worry about anybody's dirty feet. You follow what I'm saying there? See, the devil just kind of steal that from you. Now, who came to the movie night Friday night? How many of y'all were here? Huh? Wasn't that a great movie? So it's about a rich man and a poor man that became friends. Genuine friends. And as the rich man was reaching out to the poor man, they started to build their relationship. He said, you people, I know y'all have a catch and release. Then y'all catch fish and just release them. He said, where I came from, we didn't catch and release our fish. We were proud of our fish. We took them home, showed them the whole neighborhood, and cleaned them. We all ate the fish. And what he was asking the guy, are you just going to catch me as a friend and then release me someday? And see, there's no catch and release program with Jesus. He said to them, follow me, I'll make you become fishers of men. He doesn't mean you catch them, get them saved, and then let them go. No, we're going to catch them. We're going to put them in chair two. We're going to have people to teach them and encourage them and build them up and help them grow. Then we'll help them get into chair three and learn how to minister there. See, it's not a catch and release. I mean, we're with each other until the last day. We're with each other until I draw my last breath. We're with each other until the rapture comes and the trumpet blows and we all meet the Lord together in the air. There's no catch and release program here. Y'all following that? Helping the vulnerable. Helping the vulnerable is one aspect of ministry. And the Bible is full of scriptures, and I didn't want to wear y'all down with this, so I've taught it before. Deuteronomy 15, God, give generously to the poor, not grudgingly, for the Lord your God will bless you in everything you do. Zechariah 7:10, oppress not the widow, nor the fatherless, the stranger, nor the poor. We call that the quartet of the vulnerable, widow ladies, orphans, strangers, poor people. And then Proverbs 14:31, those who oppress the poor insult their maker, but helping the poor honors him. So helping the vulnerable is just one of many, many ministries at Return. In fact, I tell you what, I'm going to show you a video. This is Mike. The reason I'm showing the video of Mike, because you've all been involved in his life for 3 years. He came to church many, many times. He's down in Florida at a drug recovery program. And he's doing great down there. Amen. And I just wanted to share with you a little bit.
Hey, everybody. I've had a really hard time today struggling with this video and trying to have a preconceived idea of what I was going to say and write. And that's just not going to work out for me. So what I am going to do is just tell the truth. About 3 years ago, I was introduced to Bobby and Ted out on 22nd Street at the McDonald's. I remember talking with them for a little while, and I remember them leaving. And I remember leaving them, and I thought to myself, those guys actually listened to me and talked to me, and they actually seen something in me other than me being a drug addict out on 22nd Street. So week by week, they would come out, and we would meet them every day, and we would talk, and I started to form a bond with these guys. And eventually, I got the pleasure of meeting Pastor Bill, and ended up talking with Bill. The first time I remember, I didn't want anything to do with him. He really intimidated me. Really, he really made me nervous. And I could not figure out why these people weren't judging us and wasn't being mean to us. And so this went on with Pastor Bill for a little while. And then, you know, I ended up coming around to him slowly, very slowly. But I came around. And I remember when I first came to Return Church, I was really scared and really nervous because all my life I've had a preconceived idea of God and who he was, and him sitting up in his chair and looking at me with that real angry look on his face, because I always felt like I let him down, because I always felt like he was judging me. So when I started coming to Return, I learned that our God isn't a judgmental God at all. He's not a hateful God. Jealous, but not hateful or judgmental. And I really found myself for the first time ever, and really built a really strong foundation for the first time in my life at Return Church. And I'm eternally grateful for Return Church and the congregation as a whole. Because believe it or not, every one of you guys helped save my life. And just by not judging me and accepting me as a normal human being and as a person, and not a druggie or a drug addict. And that's about the best advice that I could give to anybody, is just when you're dealing with people with addiction and alcoholism, treat them kindly. Treat them like they was one of your children. Treat them like a child of God. Because that's what we all are. 104 days sober is only by the grace of God. I'm not confused about that today in the littlest bit. And God has talked to me. I've heard him in my head. And when I finally started listening to that little voice inside my head, when it was telling me to do something right, but Michael wanted to do it his way, you know, I understand today that, you know, that's the God conscious inside me. And ever since I started listening to that voice, life has just been remarkable. So I guess that's pretty much all there is to say at this point. Thank you guys, and we miss you all very much, but we're not missing the cold weather up there at all. Bye.
Thought you'd be blessed by that, because evangelism's relational, discipleship's relational, ministry's relational. It's about building friends. And, you know, Mike got saved. Mike got baptized here in his church. He's, what do you say, 104 days sober. And, you know, the neater thing in my mind, I've become very close friends with Mike. I mean, a real friendship. And I think Mike and I will be friends for the rest of our life. And that's such a precious, I never dreamed I would get that as a bonus in the whole thing. So this relational evangelism is so rewarding when you see people do better and better. If we're to help the lost and the believer, which one's more important? Neither. And even the minister. And even if you're in the minister chair, you need ministering too also. And then hopefully we'll all move up to the disciple maker chair. You like my font? See, the font's big, and then disciples littler, down lower. That means when you reach the final chair, you're not the big shot, you become the servant, right? It's all about serving. Ministry's all about serving. It's all about the low place. One of the biggest crimes in Christianity is for people in the church to be fighting over ministry. I mean, it's just a horrible thing. And it divides a church and kills the spirit and runs people off. So what, everybody in your ministry you can't get along with? Just love your way through the conflict. I promise if you've got a big disagreement, if you'll drop to your knees and pull out your towel and figure out a way to start loving on that person, that hate will turn to love. That disquietness will turn to peace. That anger will turn to calm if you'll learn how to wash people's feet. Amen. All right, I'm just going to fly through this. I like that sign there. I used to be your neighbor. Now he's still our neighbor, right? He may have lost his job, lost his family, he's on the street. He's still our neighbor. Love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus said, Matthew 25, just go home and read the sheep and the goats. He said, when you've done it unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. You know, when I'm over in West Side washing feet, I don't even see them as a person. I see them as Jesus. He said it so clear, when you do it unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. Faith without works is dead. Write that scripture down. James 2, 14 through 17, go home and read it. Very powerful scripture. And then write, you know, John 3, 16. Write down 1 John 3, 16. You need to memorize that one as much as you have John 3, 16. John 3, 16 gets quoted more than any verse in the Bible. This 1 John 3, 16, we act like it's a brand new verse. And then Isaiah 58 will teach you how to fast. Some people are proud of their fast because they can go without eating 3 days with nothing but water, 5 days. I went 5 days, nothing but water one time, and I thought I was going to die. I just thought I was going to die. But a real fast is this. Is not this the kind of fasting I've chosen? To loose the chains of injustice, to untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and provide the poor wanderer with shelter when you see the naked, to clothe them? Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, here am I. If you do away with the yoke of the oppression and with the pointing finger and the malicious talk, and if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in darkness and your night will become like the noonday. Isn't that powerful? That's what a real fast is. Okay, summary, we're going home. We're commanded to love everybody. Our neighbor is everybody. That's ministry, evangelism, discipleship. It's totally relational. Number two, we're on a progressive spiritual journey from the seeker chair, the believer, the minister, to the disciple maker. All ministry is about serving and washing the dirty feet of others. All mature Christians should be involved in ministry. Christians are to help the most vulnerable of our community. So if you're a mature Christian and you've been sitting in this chair for a long time and you just enjoy getting fed, God's trying to nudge you today to take a leap of faith and let's move over to chair three. You need to find out what God wants you to do. If you want to work within the confines of the church, then pray, where does God want me? What does he want me to build at Return? There may be people here that need to be running a small group, but you just hadn't wanted to do it. And maybe God's talking to you now and putting it on you. You know you need to do it. There may be people that need to mentor a new Christian, but you hadn't wanted to take the time, but God's put some people in your path. And he's probably calling you right now. I want you to reach out and mentor that person. See, that's ministry. Maybe there's some people here that need to teach a discipleship class. You've got a lot of knowledge and a lot of wisdom, and you need to share and work. There might be people that should go with us Thursday to Portland and help serve food to the poor. There's probably a prayer ministry or two that needs to be birthed here at Return. I'm seeing a whole lot of things that need to come to birth, and it's never going to happen as long as you just stay here, believer. Now, if you're a brand new Christian still pooping in your diaper, don't move. Just stay right there till you learn how to eat and learn how to be potty trained, all right? But once you mature and can eat some meat, you need to get over here in the third chair and learn to wash people's feet. I'm not promising you an exalted job, Because ministry's not going up to the high place, it's going down to the low place. That's what it's all about. Amen.